Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Tommy Kreitz. I serve as the co-campus pastor on our Elgin campus and also the lead pastor of our student ministries across all of our campuses. We are so glad that you are with us today, joining us, watching with us. Listen, in the comments or the chat below, just let us know where you're watching from. We love knowing that, and we would love to connect with you in the comments and in the chat today as well. Well, you might see some new faces on stage. We have our worship leader cohort with us online, and we're so thankful for them. We've loved our time together with them over the past year, and we thank God for them and the work of the ministry that they're doing week in and week out. And listen, maybe you or someone you know is interested in joining the worship leader cohort in 2021. Well, you can find all of the details. There's an application right there at harvestnow.info. You can go there right now. We'd love to see you in that next year. Well, we've got, as we're continuing in our series, The Road to Reality, we have Pastor Jeff Thompson bringing God's Word to us today. Jeff serves as the campus pastor at the Cathedral campus, and he leads the campus pastors across all of our campuses. He's married to Sarah Beth, and they have three great kids. And I don't know if you know this, but he's also a marathon runner. So, you know, cheer him on next time. I think he's going for 2021 Chicago Marathon. I might join him. I don't know. We'll see. Maybe not. I don't know. We'll see. Hopefully. But we are so excited that he's bringing God's Word to us today. We can't wait to hear from God through his word, through Pastor Jeff. Well, the elders sent out an update on Friday, and in case you missed it, you can go ahead and check that out at harvestnow.info. And later on in our service, we're going to be celebrating communion, remembering communion together, the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. We're going to be remembering that as a church. And so if you haven't already, grab some juice, grab a cracker or some bread, and be ready for that during the service today. Well, I just want to invite you to join us in worship in spirit and truth wherever you're at today. Let's worship the Lord.
Hey, welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel. We're so glad you're joining us today. It's a special day because we have worship leaders from all around the country leading with us here on the stage. And so it's awesome that you guys are here. This is the Vertical Worship Cohort. And back in August, we got to write a song together at the Cathedral campus down in the city. And we're going to sing one of those songs for you right now. So this song is called Beautiful.
As the morning breaks and the sun will rise, we lift our eyes toward the light. Glory falls, come and fill this place as we lift a song of highest praise.
Oh Lord,
for you are beautiful, for you.
Let your speed.
Yeah.
As we continue in worship, I want to welcome you to our online service. My name is Tommy, and I serve as a pastor here at Harvest. And we're so thankful that you've joined us today. And if you're new, we want to extend a special welcome to you. Thank you for joining us. We're so glad that you're here. And whether you're new or you've been coming week after week, we want to invite you now to check in. You can do that in the link in the comments or the chat, or you could do it through the Harvest app. We love knowing that you're here every single week, and we would love to be praying for you this week as well. So thank you so much for doing that. You know, we're so thankful to God for his faithfulness and through the faithful giving of our church. And as the weeks of 2020 come to an end, we would encourage you to continue giving to the Lord and giving gifts to the Lord as he's working in our church. And you can do that in four different ways. You can do that online at harvestbiblechapel.org. You can do it through text. You can do it through a mobile app. Or you can send your gift through the mail to the Rolling Meadows campus. And I would invite you to do that today, or you can do that anytime this week. Well, 2020 brought a lot of changes, and maybe a change in work or the workplace. And we just want to let you know that Harvest is hiring. And so if you or someone you know want to invest their expertise or their experience into the church, they could go to harvestnow.info and they could get all of the details right there. Well, we are approaching Thanksgiving, and we have great ministries that happen during Thanksgiving time. We have our compassion ministry, and we have our Thanksgiving meal ministry, and we would love to have you serve in one of those ministries. And you can do that on our various campuses. You can do that through the food pantry by making sure that it is full and ready for Thanksgiving. And then also you can deliver and help give a Thanksgiving meal to a family who is in need. And this isn't just for people who want to serve, but also if you find yourself in need in this season, these opportunities are available for you, and we would love for you to check those out at harvestnow.info. Well, would you pray with me as we continue in our service? God, we come before you right now, and we are so thankful that we can come and worship you and worship your name. Lord, your promise is true, that when we draw near to you, you draw near to us. And so, Lord, draw near to us now as we worship your name, as we hear from your word. And God, we know that you are here with us, and we are so thankful to be able to worship you wherever we are right now, wherever we're watching. Lord, we worship your name. We give you all of the glory. Lord, be with us as we hear from your word. Would you challenge our hearts? Would you challenge our minds as we hear from your word through Pastor Jeff? God, be with us. We give this service to you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, would you continue in worship with us as we sing to the Lord?
Cannot survive when we pray. what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. Well, this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. The fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side forever. All creation cry, God, we praise you. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giant fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side forever.
Psalm 27, it says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And then in verse 13 and 14, it says, I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Yes, yes, yes.
So wait for the Lord.
Yes.
Be strong and let your heart take courage.
Yes.
Oh, wait for the Lord.
Wait on.
Oh, he's on our side. He's on our side. Oh, whom shall I fear?
Yes, God.
My life when I'm lost. When I'm weary, he is my peace in the room.
every tongue confess that you are, you are, you are, you are Lord.
Lord, you are Lord.
Demons will back up at the sound of the name. The Bible says at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. The Bible also says that if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal the land. Father, we come to you this morning because our land needs healing, oh God. Father, we ask you for your divine direction, Father. We pray for our president, oh Father. Father, we pray for our nations, for our government right now in the name of Jesus. And Father, you are in control. At the end of the day, you are in control. Father, have your way. Father, bless your people, God, in the name of Jesus. We claim it done. The victory already belongs to us. And it's in that matchless name, that powerful name, that name that's above every name. And at that name, that name, Jesus. Let the church say amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Well, hey, Harvest, I'm so excited to be with you today. As was said, my name is Jeff Thompson, and I get the privilege of serving at our Chicago Cathedral campus. So I live in the city, and I love that video that our communications team has put together, just the driving through the city at night. You know, one of my favorite places to do that is Lower Wacker Drive. And there's a lot of movies that have had this. Batman, The Dark Knight has been in Lower Wacker Drive, and a classic, Blues Brothers. But one of the things, if you're ever driving at Lower Wacker Drive in this city, you know that you can't rely on your GPS. You can't be reliant on Google Maps, because if you are, you know, it's not figuring out where you are. It can't tell if you're going the right direction. Sometimes it thinks you're in the Chicago River. And if you rely on Google Maps through all that, you're going to end up turning the wrong direction, probably in the auto impound where everybody's cars get towed to, and you'll just be lost for a long time. Because that's not true reality. There's great confusion and great frustration and great craziness even in our world. There's tons that would distract us and overwhelm us, tons that the enemy would use to try to divide us or even destroy us. And in the midst of all of that craziness, we as believers need to be grounded in God's word so that we see our true reality. We're continuing in our series today called The Road to Reality, and we're looking at these 7 mile markers throughout the book of Romans to ground our reality. And the question for each one of us, each and every week, is, are you living that reality? Are you headed in the right direction on that road? And God's word gives us the direction. That's my hope for you and for me today. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful for your perfect word and the way that you instruct us from it. God, direct us in the way that you would have us to live. Fix our eyes upon you and the reality that is there. And in the midst of all that we see in our world and all that's happening in our own lives, would we ground ourselves in the truth of God's word so that you may be glorified in us and through us in this world, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, grab a hold of your Bibles. We are continuing in Romans, so grab a hold. Turn over to Romans 5. We're going to be in 5, 1 through 11 today. And Romans is a theologically rich book of the Bible. A.W. Tozer once said that what you think about God is the most important thing about you. So we're shaping and reshaping our thinking to change us more into the image of Jesus Christ, more into what God wants us to be, so that we can have a greater impact in this world for Jesus Christ. There's a world that desperately needs him, and he's choosing to use us as his missionaries to that world. Romans isn't just a book that's rich with theology, it's also a book that's rich with mission, that it's sending us out. These truths that we're studying, the understanding that we get of our salvation and of what God has done in us, that drives us to greater mission for him. And regardless of what has happened in my life in the past, regardless of what has happened in our world in this past season or in our nation in this past week or in our church in the past few years, our job is to make disciples. Our job is to fulfill the Great Commission, to bring glory to God by making disciples. And that's what we're seeking to do. We're continuing. We want to see people grow in worshiping Christ, in walking with Jesus Christ, in working for Christ, and in witnessing for him. That's why we're here. This is our reality. And all of it begins with our understanding of God's word. All of it begins with our grasping the reality of the gospel, that we were sinners separated from Jesus Christ, alienated from God because of our sin, wallowing in death and sin, and yet at that very moment, while we were yet sinners, Jesus Christ died for us to reconcile us to God, to make us right before God. His death ransomed us from our sin and from death and brought us into a right relationship with God, so that when you turn from your sins and embrace Jesus Christ by faith, you've begun a new reality. Behold, the old is gone, the new has come. That is our reality. So when life feels complex or uncertain or painful or we lack clarity, and that's often, the answer is found in grounding our reality in the gospel of Jesus Christ. When I rejoice in what has been done for me and what is being done in me, and what will be done for me, I have lasting hope. Let's see it in God's word. Romans 5, 1 through 11. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would even dare to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. In this section of Romans, Paul is instructing us on the results of our salvation and our justification for those who've been found in Jesus Christ. He's telling us what our reality is. He's telling us what we have, and he's instructing us on what our response need to be because of that reality. We are rejoicing in hope. That's what Paul's telling us here, to rejoice in the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. And first, I rejoice in his grace. Paul here is pointing back to the last verse in chapter 4 where he says, Jesus our Lord, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. What he's saying here is because we've been justified by faith, because our sin made us enemies of God, But through faith in Jesus Christ, we've been made right. We've been declared righteous by the judge. You were, and I am, guilty before the Lord of all of the crimes that we've committed. We should stand condemned and pay for those crimes. But instead of a guilty verdict as we deserve, we're declared righteous. Every single claim of the law has been satisfied in Jesus Christ for you. And it's not even like in our culture where you're declared not guilty. No, no, no. You're declared righteous, perfect, because of what Jesus Christ has done. That's how God sees you if you're a child of Him. If you have faith in Jesus Christ, you are declared righteous. And now we have peace with God. Once we were armies at war with the Lord, and now peaceful friends. This isn't a feeling of peace. It's not, you know, I have peace about the fact that I'm going to go get tacos later. It's not a peace about a decision. It's not a feeling of peace. It's an objective reality. You are at peace with God because of what Jesus Christ has done. Because you've been declared righteous and now you have peace. And now it says that we have access into God's grace. You know, recently we were locked out of our car. If you've ever had that happen, you know how fun that could be. We didn't have access to our car. The car was there, but no access to it. And we had to call a locksmith, and they showed up, and I paid him a lot of money, and he gave us access to our car again. And without that locksmith, I wouldn't have had access to my car, but now we do. And we have access, entrance into this grace of God because of Jesus Christ. It's an incredible reality that we ground our faith on. And now it says that we stand, we're firmly planted in His grace, that nothing can take that away from you because you stand in His grace. This grace is it's the hope of the glory of God, the text says. It's a hope that He will again display His glory on each of us. Remember, every single human being is created in the image of God. We're image bearers of God, so we hold a portion of His glory by nature of the fact that we were created by Him in His image. But Romans 3:23 says that all have sinned and what? Fallen short of the glory of God. Part of that glory is missing from us because we have broken the relationship. But what we're promised in Jesus Christ is that at the end, on that last day, we will be glorified by Him. His glory will once again rest upon us as His redeemed creatures. It will be displayed in us. I've begun in this grace that's been given to us, but it will be shown fully when I'm glorified. And when we see this idea of grace in Scripture, what it's talking about is God's lavish kindness that treats us better than we deserve. And we experience this grace now because we've been declared and we are righteous because of Jesus' death. We have this grace and this peace now, and we're promised glorification when the end comes. We have both the experience of today and the expectation of that day. And that is a beautiful combination. We're to rejoice. We're to boast in that. It's to take joy in. It's to be a cause of celebration in us that we have His grace and He's working in us and we will be glorified. We have this hope. It's a confident expectation, looking forward with that expectation that it will come about because God has promised that it will come about. But think back a moment with me for the day when you first trusted in Jesus Christ, when you first became a Christian, the repentance that you had over the reality of your sin, the recognition of your utter need for a Savior. The realization that I can't do this on my own. This response and receiving of this gift of salvation that's freely given to us in the forgiveness of our sins. And then the rejoicing of the grace that's been received. Though you were dead, now you're alive. Though you were in darkness, now you're in light. Though you were far from God, now you've been brought near. And though you were broken, now you've been made whole and restored and healed. Brothers and sisters, that is great joy and cause for rejoicing in our lives. But what tends to happen with so many of us who've been following the Lord for a number of years is that we forget practically that simple and that life-altering truth. One of the most repeated commands in all of God's word is to remember. Remember what God did. Remember where he brought you from. Remember how he's changed you. We're told to return to your first love, to the first things of the gospel. And these first things that we're talking about aren't just first and then we move on to greater things. No, they're first in terms of foundation. And these are the elements that we need to continually be remembering, that we need to be preaching the gospel to ourselves each and every day, this reality of God's grace. What part of this have you been forgetting? Where do you need to return to your first love that's found in Jesus Christ? Do you need to be reminded of the brokenness that we have and where Jesus saved you from and the grace that he's given you? So often we let the cares of this life crowd out our love for God, but we're called to return to him, to remember, to rejoice in hope, even in the midst of difficult times, even when our heart is breaking. Because we can be secure in his grace, we stand in that, and we have great hope for this glorification that will come in the future. Now, verse 2 talks about everything that happens at the beginning of the Christian life and what's going to happen at the end of the Christian life. But Paul, what about everything that happens in between? Well, that's his next section. I not only rejoice in his death, Jesus' death, I rejoice in my sufferings. He says, not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that our suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. Now, just a little side here. I have learned that sufferings are good for me. I mean, I don't like any of those. But I've come to the point where I've realized, okay, I get it. Those trials are good for me. And with a whole lot of work and a whole lot of prayer, I've gotten to the point where I'm thankful for the sufferings and the trials in my life. Because I know that it leads me to greater things in the Lord, that it builds these things that he's talking about. But can I just say, I'm not here yet. I'm not to the point where I'm rejoicing in my sufferings, that I'm boasting in them, that I'm taking great joy, that it's a cause of celebration. I have a lot of work to do in this area, and so much so that I've decided I think I'm going to make this t-shirt, and I'm going to wear this t-shirt around a whole lot and just begin to say that I love suffering, and maybe I'll get there. We don't rejoice because of the pain. Because that would be masochistic. We rejoice because we know that our suffering is producing something good. It's like no one rejoices in kale. You don't rejoice in the kale. You might rejoice that it's a healthy option and later on maybe I'll get healthier because I'm eating kale. But no one rejoices in kale. But that's what we're called to do here, is we're called to rejoice in our suffering because it grows endurance. It leads us to character and to hope. If any of you have been a part of a weightlifting regimen, clearly I have not anytime recently, but if you have, you know that what's actually happening to your muscles when you're lifting those weights that are heavier than you're used to is the muscle actually tears. It's actually ripping inside you, which is kind of gross. Sorry for those of you who are a little squeamish today, but your muscle is tearing. And then as you rest, that muscle is built back bigger and stronger. But if there's no tearing, there isn't any building up. You have to have the tearing down in order to have the building up. When we encounter hardship in our lives, God is using that tearing down to build us up. He's building our spiritual muscles through it. It doesn't feel great at the time, but he's working through it. And this hope is the confidence that he is using this in order to build us, to bring us closer to what he wants to do in us. We can trust him for the future, not just for my future in this life, but my future for all eternity, because of the good that he's producing, even out of the garbage of my life. That's how you grow in endurance. And every one of us wants to grow in endurance. Every one of us wants to be stronger than we were before, to be more resilient, to be able to take the garbage that this world would throw at you and to respond with joy and with grace and with a quiet trust in the Lord. And the answer to that is to press into the Lord in the midst of the suffering. Oh, to see the difficult things of my life with a lightness and a joy and an assurance that God is working right now for my good. It brings a calm assurance. Scripture tells us that we should be like a weaned child with its mother. That's the calm that we should have in the midst of the storm as we rejoice in the sufferings that we're going through. We can forget these things so easily when we get a diagnosis from the doctor, or when we hear about the injustice in our world, or when we are struggling with the trouble that our kids are getting into and the hurt that's there, or when we see this evil in our world, when someone we love is hurt or threatened, or our finances don't add up, or things just don't make sense to us. We all experience these sufferings. And some of this suffering is caused by you, and some of it's caused by others, and some of it's caused by seemingly random events in our world. But whatever the case, we can rejoice because God is using these things to shape us. And you know, as a church, we've for sure gone through some struggling recently. Some of it has been caused by us. Some of it has been caused by others. We've sought to do what is right before the Lord in each situation, but we've for sure fallen short at times. At times we've been unloving in how we've communicated. At times we've failed to believe the best about one another. At times we've allowed things to overwhelm us and to bring us to a place that produces fear and anxiety where only trust in the Lord should be. And I hope you know that your staff and your elders are on their knees frequently praying this prayer. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Because whatever comes, we're seeking to learn from the trials. We're seeking to grow in endurance through them. We're wanting to rely on the Lord in a greater way, to love one another in a better way, and to always seek his glory alone. We're asking the Lord to show us, to recognize patterns of sin in us, and to help us in repenting of those things. If you've sought to do that in your life, you know that that is a painful process, and it's so good. But that's what God calls us to. And I hope that you are doing this in your own life. I hope that you're praying that prayer. Search me, God. I want to see where I have fallen short. I want to see how I can better love you and love others and grow in it. And if not, take some time this week and do that. It's painful and it's so good because he is so faithful. This is a crucial element in our suffering, that when we go through trials, to take the time to call out to the Lord in them, and he will instruct us through those. As I've done these things, there's been a great brokenness in me and honestly a tenderness in my heart that I've not seen before, and I really hope doesn't go away. Because in the sufferings of my life, I want to rejoice in them as they're producing endurance in me. Hebrews 12:11 says, "For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it." So are you being trained by it? Because these should be reasons for us to boast. God is working in us, and in the midst of immense pain that you're feeling it right at the heart of the trial, great rejoicing can come from setting your mind on what God is doing through it. For me, in some of the greatest difficulties of my life, the simple prayer that has kept me seeking the Lord has been, "God, I believe that you're going to do something incredible through this. I don't see it. I don't feel it right now. I don't even see a way out of it. But Lord, I believe what you've said in your word. I believe that this will produce endurance in me, that it will produce character in me, that it will lead me to greater hope in you and greater trust in you. And so God, I believe that you're going to do something incredible in the garbage that I see right now, because I know that you are faithful. Because he turns sorrow into joy. He turns mourning into dancing. He turns our tears into laughter. And he turns our grief into glory for him." So get the "I Love Suffering" t-shirt. We're going to actually sell these in the lobby this weekend. No, not really, but maybe we will. That would be something fun. But get on God's plan of rejoicing in the midst of suffering, because suffering produces endurance. It's the idea of keep on going, of standing firm, of holding fast with bravery and courage in the middle of the storm. And this character that's developed in us, it's to determine the genuineness of something through testing, through examination. So it's like taking that piece of jewelry, taking that ring that's been in your family for generations, and taking it over to the jeweler and having them examine it and put it through the test to see the genuineness of the diamond, to see the character of that piece of jewelry. That's what God is doing in you in the midst of the trial. And we're watching him carry us through the suffering to endurance, to greater character, and it gives us greater hope that he will in fact glorify us. And it says that our hope is not put to shame. It means you won't be disappointed in this hope. God won't leave you in that. God's amazing and generous love is the proof that our hope will not disappoint us. Notice in the text in verse 5, it says, "Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us." God's love is the central theme of all of God's word. And in 1962, there's a theologian, his name is Karl Barth, studied scripture, studied theology for his entire life. And in 1962, he was giving a lecture here in Chicago at the University of Chicago in Rockefeller Chapel on their campus there. It's a beautiful building. But he's there giving this lecture. And at the end of the time, someone came up and asked him and said, "You know, Dr. Barth, would you be able to take your entire life's work in theology, everything that you know about God, everything that you've learned from the scriptures, would you be able to take that and synthesize it, just put it down to one sentence for me?" What did he say? There's so many things that he could have said from God's word. What did he say? He said this simple line, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." That's the central theme of God's word. That's what we see in God's word. That's why we have this hope, because of God's incredible love for us. And I'm so grateful for a worship team who spends a lot of time writing songs about God's love. And we've seen so many written throughout the years, but it's because so many have tried to put words to the unending, overflowing love of our Lord. Frederick Lehman in 1917 wrote the hymn, "The Love of God." It's a fairly familiar one, but he says, "The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care, God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. There is no end to God's love for us. We're told in 1 John 4:18 to not fear. There's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. We need not fear judgment because God's love floods over us. It says that God's love is poured into our hearts. And so many of us believe that. We believe that God's love is poured into my heart, and I experience his love for me. I'm filled because God loves me so much. But what this is telling us is that it's overflowing, that God's love for you and for me is so immense that it cannot be contained. It is overflowing to us. That's the love of God that we see in this passage. That's the love of God that we see over and over in the pages of Scripture. And that is our reality, that his love is poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. And I have to confess, far too often, even in the midst of that love, I have come too slowly to the Lord to acknowledge him at work. I've come kicking and screaming at times. I've come a little more like the Israelites murmuring in the wilderness than I would like. But wherever you're at, whether it's quick or slow to return to the Lord, his love is for you and overflowing in your life. And he desires that we would lean on him to grow in endurance. And that is how we rejoice in our suffering. And then we rejoice in his death. I rejoice in his death. He says, "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would even dare to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." We were weak and helpless, unable to save ourselves or bring about any change in our life, and yet Jesus Christ died for us. Don't miss the fact that this love is for those who clearly don't deserve it, for you and for me. And until you feel the full weight of your brokenness and sin that put Jesus Christ on the cross, you won't fully grasp his overflowing love for you. This casts out judgment and hypocrisy and selfishness and pride, because all of these have in them an element of I deserve something. Scripture's so clear, we deserve nothing. And Paul is saying here, man, it's super rare that a person would die for someone who's morally upright. And you know, I might be willing to die for a person who's done a lot of good for me. Might. But in contrast of that, our Savior dies for us. We have no righteousness in and of ourselves. We've done no good for him at all. And yet he's given himself for us. Jesus, the perfect, spotless lamb in my place and in your place. We get the privilege today of celebrating communion, of remembering the Lord in communion. And his body was broken for us, and his blood was poured out for us. Jesus, the perfect, spotless lamb, given for us. We come to the communion table, we remember the Lord's death. We remember that he was broken for us, that he was poured out for us. And we get this great picture in Scripture of how we're to remember the Lord's death, to look back and remember what Jesus Christ has done for each one of us, that we can celebrate his payment for you and for me, This is a time for those of us who know Jesus Christ. And it's a time for us to focus on all that he's done for us. To remember our brokenness and our sin and our need for him. And to celebrate the fact that he was broken for us and poured out for us. Jesus Christ in my place. This is our reality. But you know, God's word also tells us that as often as we eat the bread and drink the cup, that we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. We're looking back at what God has done in my life through Jesus Christ, and we're looking forward to the future, to when he will return and make all things new. And so we take the bread that's been broken for you. We've been made right because of what Jesus has done for us. His body was broken, and we rejoice together in his sacrifice for us. Let's take together. And we take the cup, the blood of the new covenant that was shed for your sins and for mine to bring us into a right relationship. My blood should have been shed, but his was in my place. We rejoice together because of his sacrifice for us. Let's take. But God shows his own love for us in that while we were still sinners, Jesus Christ died for us. This is the display of love for us. This is the overflowing of his love for you. Jesus Christ in your place. And he's brought us into a right relationship with him because of that. We rejoice in his death for us. And we rejoice in his life. Paul tells us here that we've been reconciled. This is the language of friendship. More than justification, which is a legal term, this is the language of friendship, that we've been brought near. Where once there was separation, now there's nearness. Where once there was estrangement, now there's fellowship. Where once there was enmity, now there's friendship. You weren't just apart from God. You weren't just separated from God. You were an enemy of God, at war with him. And Jesus' death made a way for you and I to be brought near. To be brought near as a friend. And hey, we're not even the good friend. We're like that really bad friend who never texts you back and who always shows up late to everything and who suddenly forgets their wallet every time you go out to dinner and who tends to turn every conversation to, oh yeah, that reminds me about me. I hope you're not that kind of friend. But that's how we are to the Lord. We're the bad friend, and yet he still loves us. And Paul's saying, look at the way that Jesus can save you. He's taken you from an enemy to a friend, and his resurrected life is poured into you. And you're brought into right relationship. Paul ends this section by saying, not only are we saved, we rejoice in him. Because of what he's done for us, because we've been made right with God, because our brokenness has been restored, because you've been made a friend of God, you've been reconciled. And because of all of that, Paul's message to us is that because you have been reconciled, our job is to help others be reconciled to God as well. Remember, this is a missional book. And because of what's been changed and transformed in you, we're called to go out and to serve and to bring this good news of Jesus Christ in our place to a world that desperately needs him. All that we see in the news each and every day, the darkness that we see on our street, the hurt that we see in our neighbors, the pain that we hear about from those we work with, the answer to all of that is Jesus on the cross for our sins. That is the only thing that will fix our world. That is the only thing that will redeem is the blood of Jesus Christ poured out. The body of Jesus Christ broken for a world that desperately needs a Savior. And my job and your job is to carry that message to them, to carry that good news of Jesus Christ, to rejoice in hope in such a way that it leads us to work and to witness for Jesus Christ. So how will you be sent out this week? Rather than trapped in your sin or wallowing in your circumstances, seeking to serve others and carry this good news. Maybe you need to send a text message as soon as the service is over. Maybe you need to call a friend and set up a time to go grab coffee with them and explain the good news of Jesus Christ. Maybe you need to write a letter to somebody. We're trusting the Lord that He'll lead us in this, but our job is to continue to carry this gospel in the midst of a world that is suffering without a Savior. We need to bring that Savior to them. Who's that person in your life that desperately needs to hear this message of Jesus Christ on the cross for them? Because when I rejoice in what's been done for me and what is being done in me and what will be done for me, I have lasting hope. Let's pray together. Father, we are so grateful for your incredible love that is poured out to us, for the rejoicing that we can have in all seasons of our life, because we know that you are at work. We recognize, Lord, that you began a good work in us. We recognize, Lord, that you're continuing that even when it hurts, even when our hearts are heavy, even when we experience great pain and suffering. Lord, you are there in the midst of that trial. So help us to turn to you in a greater way, Lord. Help us to trust you in a greater way. Help us to take your gospel to a world that desperately needs you. We recognize the hope that we have that is found only in Jesus Christ. And we would pray that that hope would be declared for all people, that your glory would be seen, Lord, not just in us, but in our whole world, that the name of Jesus would be lifted high and that you would be worshiped by all people and tribes and tongues and nations, because only Jesus can satisfy, because only Jesus can redeem, and because only Jesus can save and restore. And it's in His name that we pray. Amen.
Good. Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress. Oh, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, and you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, oh, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. 'Cause you shine in the shadows, and you nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet. Oh, and I'll sing through the night. Oh,
what an incredible reality, an incredible anthem cry for us to cry out this week. God, this battle that I'm going through, it belongs to you, God. What you've brought me through, what you're doing in me now, what you will do for me in the future, all of that is a cause of rejoicing in him. Have a great week in the Lord. You are loved.